So, yeah, so they're telling me that, you know, first one's down in the dock tomorrow. We're going to get, we'll take on, we need three crew, four more bodies, right? So I thought, great. So I go to my pizza, cleaning. Captain's keg, washing dishes. I got done at 11 o'clock at night. It's what time of year was that? That was probably December. So the weather's nasty. Sun comes up probably at 10 in the morning, goes down at like 3:30. So 9:30 rises, goes down at 3:34, something like that, 4:30. Yeah, it's probably the darkest time of the year, right before the solstice. And I think there was snow at the time too. So I get done with my dishwashing thing. I go, shit. And then my bunker, the World War II bunker, is out at about 2 miles outside of town. And so I'd have to always steel myself to walk home, you know, on this one road and with the snow up, and then climb this cliff to get up to the bunker. It's like, ah, so I go into Tony's, the bar there, and start, you know, having a few beers. And then I walk home. I don't know what time I got home. Going to the bunker. The bunker's like a tomb. You can't see the hand in front of your face. I mean, it's half underground. Where the front, where the gun was, there was a big steel thing that the gun was placed on with the windows. And the windows had these steel plates on tracks that you could close and shut it down, you know. And then it was, I had a door on there. I had the thing carpeted, had a bunk in there, and had a stove in there that had welded up. A friend of mine welded up in the cannery, and there was some wood up there that I burned. And then I couldn't burn wood anymore, so then I changed it to diesel. So I had a thing outside the window that with a jug with a copper wire that went into the stove, and I could regulate how much diesel. But then I'd have to hitchhike and town with a couple cans of get diesel and come back. So eventually I didn't even heat the place. I just crashed there, right? So anyway, I get back to the bunker. I fall asleep, and I had a buffalo robe that I slept under. This friend of mine gave it to me, and I didn't wake up in time. Make a long story short, I didn't wake up in time. The St. Patrick took off at 6 in the morning. They were gone. So I'm doing my regular gig. I'm at the pizza place washing dishes. There's only one radio station. It's a public radio station. I'm listening to it, and they're talking about, you know, the storm, that this big, you know, gale force 9 or whatever out there. And somebody has seen the St. Patrick. And that's the other thing. I'm half Irish, so I thought, oh, the St. Patrick, it'll be lucky for me to get on this boat, right? Somebody sees the St. Patrick wallowing in these heavy seas in Marmot Island, off Marmot Island. And but nobody on board, and there's like debris in the water. It's like a guy in a plane sees it. So all these guys go out there, throws their lines on it, tows this thing in. Now they got to start searching for the crew. End up finding two guys survived. One guy, I still remember his name. I never knew the guy, but his name was Robert Kidd. He was from Florida, because it's like a pirate's name, Robert Kidd, right? Spelled K-I-D-D. He lived. And some other guy, I don't know what his name was, but the one guy, I don't know if it was Kid or the other guy, was one of the new guys that they got, and he was helping. The skipper was one of the guys who went on vacation or whatever, the regular skipper. He went on vacation, and the first mate was this black dude. There was only like two black dudes in the whole town. Collie was one, Mike was another guy, and this guy. And so, anyway, they took a wave, according to this what these guys said, they took a wave over the wheelhouse, and this is a big boat, so it must have been a hell of a wave, knocked out all their windows and killed their engines. And this guy told them to abandon ship. It was dark, it was fucking storming. And so those new guys that didn't have survival suits, they were dead within, you know, 5 minutes. And the rest of them were in the water. There was one woman on board out of the 12-man crew. She was a native Kodiak girl. She was the cook. And the one guy who survived said, they said they're our fathers. They're floating in the water. All holy hell's breaking loose around them. You know, these waves crashing over in these survival suits. Your face is open. And you're taking these cold waves. I still have my survival suit at home. If you try to swim in them, you They're a trip. You try to swim in one time, sometime. But some of them have whistles on them. Some of them have, like, satellite things now and all this other shit. But anyway, so they get this. They get these two guys. The woman, she floated all the way back to where they found her body a mile from her house in a bay called Women's Bay. The other three, you know, the rest of the crew was dead, and these two guys lived. So I need a survival suit. I get this job on the Heidi J. This friend of mine, Rick, and Wayne, they knew this guy named Joe, who worked for the Coast Guard base. And I go, boy, I need to get a survival suit. And they go, oh, Joe can get you a survival suit. And I go, really? And Joe goes, yeah, because a survival suit cost at that time like $350. And so, and Joe goes, yeah, I got one for $50. I go, really? He goes, yeah. I go, okay, yeah, I'll buy it off you. Fuck, $50. So I buy this survival suit. And then later, like 2 days later, Rick goes, you know, I wouldn't have bought that survival suit. I go, why not? He goes, well, actually, the guy who was the black guy died in it, who was from the St. Patrick. I go, you're kidding me. And he goes, no. And I go, oh, fuck, you know. He goes, it's kind of bad juju to be wearing a dead guy's survival suit.
Somebody
that he
took him from him and sold it?
Well, he Joel fished these guys' bodies with the Coast Guard. He fished them out of the water.
Wow. Sold it.
He sold it to me for $50. So I ended up buying a new one. So I ended up cranking out the $350. I can't remember if the guy gave me my money back or not. I think he did. I went and said, hey, Joe, I don't want this fucking survival suit. And so now I found out the guy died in it, man. And I was kind of suspicious because it didn't have the bag for it, you know. You know, it comes in a white bag that you put it in. I mean, people couldn't believe it. Those people, that ship never went down. Those people were dead for no reason. That was the big tragedy of it. It was like, holy shit, he told them to abandon ship. They did. And was, like I say, those new guys. And that would, if I would have woke up that morning, that could have been me. I was stupid enough. If the guy said, go over the side, I probably would have, I don't know why, but, that's how people think. You know, you get in a fucking situation and, you know, I would have been dead. I would have known I would have been dead in 5 minutes, but it's a really stupid thing. That's what was so stupid about it. I mean, I remember thinking about it, thinking, wow, what? That's fucking crazy, man. And again, it was a very humbling experience. It taught me, you know, fuck. Yeah, look it up. Look it up. The St. Patrick, the scalloper. This was 1982, I think. 81, 82. Yeah, there was a lot of people died that year in Kodiak.